بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Welcome in the first lesson from the book تطريز رياض الصالحين, our explanation of the book of رياض الصالحين, which is one of the book that combine الكلمة الطيبة, the good words, combine أحاديث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم and the verses of the Quran and contain the جوامع الكلم, the collections of the words. And this book has been accepted by the scholars, accepted by the people, and you don't, يعني it's really rare to find a masjid without have this book. We explained before that the author of this book is Al-Imam Abu Zakaria Yahya Sharafuddin al-Nawawi. Most of you know him, and we explained before when we mentioned the 40 Nawawi hadith that he, although he is died less than 40 years old, but his books has a lot of benefit, and especially in fiqh, the al-minhaj, especially in the tafsir, part of the tafsir of Imam Muslim, Sahih Muslim, and of course, Riyad al-Salihin, al-Adhkar, Adab, Hamil al-Quran, the etiquettes of the one who carries the Quran. All of these books, the Ummah has been accepted with a pleasure, with certainty about the content of these books. So Imam al-Nawawi, like we explained before when we start Bulugh al-Maram about Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, we explained that he is from Ahl al-Sunnah and one of the Imams of Ahl al-Sunnah, but there is some objections against his way of explanation of some of the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal. He agreed with a sect called Al-Asha'ira in terms of interpretation of the sifat of Allah Azza wa Jal. For example, by saying that instead that Allah istawa, rose above the arsh, he said, or the Asha'ira said, istawla means take or control, which is of course not the same way like the Sahaba and the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم do that. But however, anyone has a shortcoming, anyone have mistake, anyone can do يعني based on his ijtihad, and may Allah forgive his ijtihad that he did. طيب نقرأ الأول, الحديث الأول في هذا الباب, وهو باب الإخلاص. باب الإخلاص أو باب the sincerity, which is very important. Before you start the عمل, you have to make sure that this عمل is sincere for Allah Azza wa Jal. And by the way, this book, the one which we're talking from, it's called Tatriz, Riyad al-Salihin. Tatriz, it is like a decoration, if you can say, means that he tried to bring the advantages and the benefit from the book of Riyad al-Salihin and put it in a very short notes, a very beautiful book written by Sheikh Faisal al-Mubarak, one of the greatest scholar from Bilad al-Haramayni, Hafizah rahimahullah. And then you will find a very easy explanation of the book, inshallah. طيب. نقرأ الباب الأول. اقرأ يا أحمد المتن بالعربي والإنجليش بإذنك.
الحمد لله رب العالمين, وصلى اللهم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. ربنا اغفر لنا ولمشايخنا وللمسلمين والمسلمات. ثم أما بعد, فيقول المصنف رحمه الله: عن أمير المؤمنين أبي حفص عمر بن الخطاب ابن نفيل ابن عبد
عبد العزة,
أحسن الله إليك, ابن عبد العزة ابن رياح ابن عبد الله ابن قرطي ابن رزاح ابن عدي ابن كعب ابن لؤي ابن غالب القرشي العدي العدوي رضي الله عنه قال: سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: إنما الأعمال بالنيات، وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى، فمن كانت هجرته إلى الله ورسوله فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله، ومن كانت هجرته لدنيا يصيبها أو امرأة ينكحها فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه. متفق على صحته. رواه إمام المحدثين
إمامة
أحسن الله. رواه إمام المحدثين أبو عبد الله محمد بن إسماعيل ابن إبراهيم ابن المغيرة ابن بردزبة الجعفي البخاري، وأبو الحسين مسلم ابن الحجاج ابن مسلم القشيري
النيسابوري
أحسن الله عليك النيسابوري رضي الله عنهما في صحيحهما اللذين هما أصح الكتب المصنفة.
طيب this hadith is the first book and every book has to be started with a hadith that like a يعني the theme of the book or the title of the book. So this book called Riyadu al-Salihin, the Garden of the Righteous. And in order to have a garden in your heart, you have to have sincerity in your heart. So this is a good selection from the author to start his book by this hadith, which is an intention or the sincerity or al-ikhlas. If you want to have your heart a garden of Iman, a garden of belief, in this case you have to have sincere. طيب اقرأ translation.
عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه reported, the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, the deeds are considered by the intentions, and a person will get the reward according to his intention. So whoever immigrated for Allah and his messenger, his صلى الله عليه وسلم, his immigration will be for Allah and his messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. And whoever immigrated for worldly benefits or for a woman to marry, his immigration would be for what he immigrated for.
طيب this hadith متفق عليه means agreed between Bukhari and Muslim narrated. This great hadith have a lot of beneficial, and every person in his amal should consider this hadith. When you pray, you have to consider why you pray. You have to be sincere. When you seek the knowledge, you have to consider that. وقال الإمام الشافعي, this hadith combines 70 section of knowledge. This hadith showed that Allah Azza wa Jal will judge about action by the intention of the person. And if the person, his immigration for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, his immigration will be for Allah Azza wa Jal and his Prophet. And if he immigrated because of the dunya, the worldly thing, he will take the reward from the dunya, not from Allah Azza wa Jal. And this, the reason of this hadith, there is a person on this time, he immigrated to Medina to marry a lady called Umm Qais. So this is his intention to marry, not to join Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, and then Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم addressed that. Also, Al-Imam Al-Hafiz Ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani said, if the person combined two niyyah in his immigration, okay, I will immigrate for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, but also to marry a woman. This, of course, incomplete reward you will get, but still يعني, accepted. Because even you marry and you migrate to marry, this is not a problem, but you will have incomplete reward like the one who only immigrated for the purposes of Allah Azza wa Jal. أيضا, al-hijra, immigration. When we take this decision, when we leave the Muslim country to non-Muslim country, and if staying in a non-Muslim country may be more preferable than staying in a Muslim country, so we have now two questions. First, when you take the decision to leave the Muslim country to non-Muslim country. Second, if you are in a non-Muslim country, it is better for you to stay here or go back to the Muslim country. طيب, what do you think? Huh? Let us share this your idea. If you are in a Muslim country, what is the thing that make you have to leave this Muslim country? Zulm, ahsant, oppression. This one reason, of course. Actually, if you are in a Muslim country, are not able to practice your deen, not able to protect your family, not able to protect yourself, your soul, not able to protect your mind, your aql, not able to protect your wealth, so you have the excuse to leave Muslim country to non-Muslim country. Vice versa, if you are in a non-Muslim country and you can practice your religion freely and you can implement the Sharia in your place, in your community, in your home, you practice the Sharia of Allah Azza wa Jal, and if you leave that to Muslim country, you are not able to do that. In this case, it is recommended to stay in the non-Muslim country if you are able to establish your deen, and also for da'wah, if you want to do da'wah, of course, will be the purposes of staying in a non-Muslim country. Type. As you can see, very short notes from the Musannif, and also يعني, comprehensive. Next hadith, number two.
أحسن الله إليكم. قال المصنف رحمه الله عن أم المؤمنين أم عبد الله عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يغزو جيش الكعبة فإذا كانوا ببيداء من الأرض يخسف بأولهم وآخرهم قالت قلت يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كيف يخسف بأولهم وآخرهم وفيهم أسواقهم ومن ليس منهم قال صلى الله عليه وسلم يخسف بأولهم وآخرهم ثم يبعثون على نياتهم أحسن الله ثم يبعثون على نياتهم متفق عليه هذا لفظ البخاري
تفضل translation.
Aisha radiallahu anha reported, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, an army will raid the Kaaba, and when it reaches a desert land, all of them will be swallowed up by the earth. She asked, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, why all of them? He answered, all of them will be swallowed by the earth, but they will be raised for judgment according to their intentions. Al-Bukhari and Muslim.
طيب. Also, this hadith is related to the intention. And as you can see in this hadith, the person will be resurrected based on his intention. If you are in a place with an oppressor and you cannot leave this oppressor and you died, Allah Azza wa Jalla will resurrect you based on your intention. But this also indicates something, that it is not recommended to stay with oppressor. ولا تركنوا إلى الذين ظلموا فتمسكم النار. Do not stay with the ظلام الظالمين, with the oppressor, so you will be touched by hellfire. So be careful. Don't stay with the ظلم. You leave the ظلم. Also, this hadith showed that the Kaaba, the Baytullah, at the end of the life, there will be an army, as you can see, and not only that, there will be a person. They called him Zuswaiqataini. He will demolish the Kaaba before the resurrection land. Demolish the Kaaba before resurrection land. He from Al-Habasha, from Abyssinia. And this is one of the sign of the Yawm Al-Qiyamah. Wal-Kaaba Baytullah banaha Adam ma'al Malaika. Adam and the angels built the Kaaba. And then when Ibrahim alayhi salam lifted his wife Hajar and his son Ismail in Mecca, and he grew there, and the Arab tribes Jurhum came and stayed there, and he married from them, and Ibrahim alayhi salam and his son Ismail raised the pillars, the foundation of the Kaaba. It was there, but it was covered, and then he came and raised it up and built the Kaaba. And then, before Prophet Muhammad became a prophet, the Quraysh wants to renovate the Kaaba, But they want to use only the pure money, the halal money, money not from zina, money not from interest, riba. And then once they start to build the Kaaba and they run out of the halal money. And then because of that, they left the northern side of the Kaaba not extended. And you can see now the Hijr Ismail or Hatim, which is semicircular. This is supposed to be from Kaaba side. But because they are shortened in the money of halal, and then they cannot. And then Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, before he passed away, he said to Sayyidah Aisha, because I'm worried that your people is still newly Muslim, hadith wa ahdin bi Islam, otherwise I will demolish the Kaaba and reestablish on the pillars of Ibrahim, mean extended. Walakin he didn't do that. Then on the time of Abdullah ibn Zubayr, which happened approximately in 63 Hijrah, he was the Khalifa over the Mecca and Medina and Iraq and Egypt, everything except Al-Sham, which is under the ruling of Bani Umayyah, Yazid ibn Muawiyah. But he was, Abdullah ibn Zubayr was rural of all that place except Sham. And then he demolished the Kaaba because he heard this hadith from his auntie Aisha. And then he extended toward the correct position of the Kaaba. And then after the fitna happened and they killed him, Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi killed him in Mecca. Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, the ruler of Bani Umayyah, demolished it and back it again to the normal. And then in the time of Khilafa Abbasiyya, I think Harun al-Rashid, one of them, asked the Imam Malik, Imam Darul Hijra, to demolish it and build again to the pillars of Ibrahim. But he said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, it will be a habit. Every king come, demolish, and then rebuild. Demolish, leave it like that. And since that, it will be the same like that until the Zuwaiqatayn will come and demolish the Kaaba before the resurrection land. طيب, hadith number 3.
قال المصنف رحمه الله وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا هجرة بعد الفتح ولكن جهاد ونية وإذا استنفرتم فانفروا. متفق عليه. ومعناه لا هجرة من مكة لأنها صارت دار إسلام. Aisha radiallahu anha narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, there is no immigration after the conquest of Mecca, but only jihad, striving and fighting in the cause of Allah and intention. But only jihad and intention. So if you are summoned to fight, go forth. Al-Bukhari and Muslim.
طيب, this also hadith set a rule of immigration from Mecca to Al-Madinah. Since the conquest of Mecca, it will not be regarded as a hijrah, as an immigration, if you migrated from Mecca to Medina, because it's now all places are Dar Islam. But walakin jihad wa niyya, also jihad, you strive for sake of Allah Azza wa Jal by your tongue, by your money, by yourself, and niyya, intentions that you do in immigration for sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, if you are not able to do. This is all. This niyya means that you will get the reward of hijrah, of immigration, even you are not migrated. So that means that you are in your home, but you have intentions that you want to migrate for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, but you're not able, but you get rewarded. والدليل على ذلك أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في غزوة تبوك عندما تأخر أو عندما تخلف بعض ضعفاء المسلمين عن الغزوة فقال إن بالمدينة رجالا ما قطعتم مسيرة ولا واديا إلا شاركوكم في الأجر. قال قالوا لما يا رسول الله قال حبسهم العذر. So Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم during the battle of Tabuk, which is a very hard battle and in the summer and long distance from Medina, about 850 kilometer, and there is no much money with the Prophet to prepare the army, and some of the Sahaba don't have enough money to go with them. And then Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said to Sahaba, there are some people in the Medina, every footstep you walk or every valley you pass through, they take the same reward like you, and they are in the Medina. And the Sahaba surprised, how that? They are in the Medina and we spend all this distance and we spend money and they have the same reward like us. And then he said, habasahum al-udhr. only they have excuse stop them for leaving the Medina to Tabuk. Also, Allah Azza wa Jal will give you the reward if you are sick or traveler, the same reward like you're doing in your home and you are healthy. For example, if you have a habit that you pray Qiyamul Layli 8 rak'at every night and you read one juz of Quran, but because you are sick, you didn't do that. It will be written for you the same reward, even you are didn't pray or you didn't read Quran. The same if you used to fast Monday, Thursday. If you fast Monday, Thursday, and you because you're sick, you didn't fast, it will be counted for you as a reward. Also, if you are travel and you didn't fast because you travel, sunnah, it will be counted for you. So this is the intention, this is the importance of intention. طيب, next hadith.
أحسن الله إليكم. قال المصنف رحمه الله عن أبي عبد الله جابر بن عبد الله أنصاري رضي الله عنهما قال كنا مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في غزاة فقال إن بالمدينة لرجالا ما سرتم مسيرا ولا قطعتم واديا إلا كانوا معكم حبسهم المرض وفي رواية إلا شاركوكم في الأجر رواه مسلم
ولا شاركوكم ولا شاركوكم في ألف ولا في ألف عندك يبقى شاركوكم على طول
إلا شاركوكم في الأجر رواه مسلم ورواه البخاري عن أنس رضي الله عنه قال رجعنا من غزوة تبوك مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال إن أقواما خلفنا بالمدينة ما سلكنا شعبا ولا واديا إلا وهم معنا حبسهم العذر. Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari radiyallahu anhuma reported, we accompanied the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in an expedition when he said, there are some men in al-Madinah who are with you wherever you march and whichever valley you cross. They have not joined you in person because of their illness. In another version he said, they share the reward with you. Muslim. It is narrated by Bukhari from Anas bin Malik radiyallahu anhu. We were coming back from the battle of Tabuk with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he remarked, there are people whom we left behind in Al-Madinah who accompanied us in spirit in every pass and valley we crossed. They remained behind for a valid excuse.
So this is a hadith I mentioned. It's very important to always have intention. It will be counted for you even you do the amal. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if the person intended to do a bad deeds and he didn't do it, it would not be counted for him. If he do it, it will be written as one sins. And if the person intend to do the righteous deed and he didn't do it, it will be count for him one. If he did it, it will be counted 10. Import of intention. Next hadith.
قال المصنف رحمه الله وعن أبي يزيد معين بن يزيد بن الأخنس رضي الله عنهم وهو أبوه وجده صحابيون قال كان أبي يزيد أخرج دنانير يتصدق بها فوضعها عند رجل في المسجد فجئت فأخذتها فأتيته بها فقال والله ما إياك أردت فخصمته إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال لك ما نويت يا يزيد ولك ما أخذت يا معن رواه البخاري معن بن يزيد بن أخنس رضي الله عنهم he, his father and his grandfather all were companions reported my father set aside some dinars for charity and gave them to a man in the mosque I went to that man and took back those dinars he said I had not intended you to be given So we went to the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and put forth the matter before him. He said to my father, Yazid, you have been rewarded for what you intended. And he said to me, Ma'an, you are entitled to what you have taken.
طيب, this hadith is have many benefit rules in fiqh. First, wakala. You can make someone wakil in behalf of you to pay the charity. What happened here? Ma'in, his father Yazid, and his grandfather is Al-Akhnas, is Sahaba. Ma'in, his father Yazid, went to the masjid and he saw a man there and said to him, take this money, give it to any maskeen. خلاص, this wakala. You give him the authority to give the in behalf of you, wakala. And then, after that, his son, means the son of Yazid, Ma'in, came, and the man gave him this money of his father. And then the dinar, he knows this is the dinars of my father. He knows this, it looks like the same like my father has. And then he surprised, he didn't accept it because he worried he is not, he's not right to take this money because his father is responsible for him. So this charity should not give it to your son. And then he came to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and explained about the importance of the niyyah. His father's niyyah is to give charity. He didn't intend to give it to his son. And then his son took it and he didn't know this is his father's money. So nothing to do. His father got the reward and his son got the dananir. Subhanallah. Barakallahu feek. Next one. وعن أبي إسحاق سعد بن أبي وقاص مالك يلا
قال المصنف رحمه الله وعن أبي إسحاق سعد بن أبي وقاص مالك بن أهيب بن عبد مناف بن زهرة بن كلاب بن مرة بن كعب بن لؤي القرشي الزهري رضي الله عنه أحد العشرة المشهود لهم بالجنة رضي الله عنهم قال جاءني رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يعودني عام حجة الوداع من وجع اشتد بي فقلت يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إني قد بلغ بي من الوجع ما ترى وأنا ذو مال ولا يرثني إلا ابنة لي أفأتصدق بثلث مالي؟
بثلثي مالي.
أحسن الله إليك. أفأتصدق بثلثي مالي؟ قال لا. قلت فالشطر يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. فقال لا. قلت فالثلث يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. قال الثلث والثلث كثير أو كبير. إنك أن تذر ورثتك أغنياء خير من أن تذرهم عالة يتكففون الناس وإنك لن تنفق نفقة تبتغي بها وجه الله إلا أجرت عليها حتى ما تجعل في امرأتك
في امرأتك فم
حتى ما تجعل في
في في
في في امرأتك
يا yeah.
أحسن الله عليك. قال فقلت يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أخلف بعد أصحابي؟ قال إنك لن تخلف فتعمل عملا تبتغي به وجه الله إلا ازددت به درجة ورفعة ولعلك أن تخلف أحسن ولعلك أن تخلف حتى ينتفع بك أقوام ويضر بك آخرون اللهم أمضي لأصحابي هجرتهم ولا تردهم على أعقابهم لكن البأس سعد
البائس
لا أحسن الله لكن البائس سعد بن خوله
يرثي له رسول الله
صلى الله عليه وسلم أن مات بمكة.
طيب, before the translation, this hadith, the last one, inshallah, has also many important rules. سعد بن أبي وقاص, one of the 10 صحابة that Allah gave them the glad tidings to Jannah. عشان بشرون أحسنت. In حجة الوداع, just before Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم passed away, he was very sick. And Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم went to visit him, and he thought Sa'd, he will die. He felt this is the illness of death. Of this comes, it means. However, subhanAllah, Sa'd ibn Waqqas stay alive after that, and he was the reason for opening of Iraq in Al-Qadisiyah, 16 Hijrah. So anyway, he asked Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم to give wasiyah, a will, and to give some charity from his money to be distributed after his death. And then he asked Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم to give 2/3 of his wealth, 66% of his wealth as a charity. But Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said so much. And then he said الشطر, half, 50% of his wealth as a charity. And then he said كثير, so much. And then he said to him third. Then Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم repeat third. However, it's okay, but it's also so much. والثلث كثير. That means that you can give wasiyah up to 30%, but according to opinion Abdullah ibn Abbas, because he's understood that Prophet didn't accept completely 30 or third. He said quarter. You can give up to quarter of your wealth as a wasiyah, as a will, but it hasn't to be to your one of their, the one who have inheritance. So you can give wasiyah to your son. You can give wasiyah to your wife, your father. Anyone have share in inheritance is not entitled to take the wasiyah from his father, whatever. Also, this hadith showed the importance of visiting the person in his illness, in his sickness. This is adab al-Muslimin, ziyarat al-Marid. Aydan, this hadith showed that when you feel that you will die, or you have some illness, you feel that you will die, you have to spend from your money in your life, because you don't know what happened after your death. Immediately, maybe the wife will wait 4 months and 10 days, and she marry another one. And the children, instead of giving charity on behalf of you, they take the money to buy whatever car, buy whatever they want. No one will take care about you after your death. So in this case, you have to take the decision by yourself in your life. Don't wait till you die, and then you ask, oh Allah, return me back. And if that happens, it will not happen. So you have to consider the wasiyah. Well, wasiyah sometimes may be preferable to give the wasiyah before the dain, the debit. So now we have some person, he died and he has dain, debit, and has wasiyah. Which one we should start first? ليس على التفصيل, ليس, it's not absolutely يعني like that. Depends. If he has money, many, lot of money left, give the wasiyah first. Why? Because the dain, have the people will ask about the dain. Because if you take a loan for someone, he will keep chasing your kids or family after your death. But the wasiyah, you take the money and the person didn't know that you wrote a wasiyah for him. Because you write the wasiyah, and then when you die, your family opens the wasiyah and read, okay, he asked to give $10,000 to this person. And this is the person this didn't know. So if يعني, you start with a debit, with a dain, then and ignore the wasiyah, maybe they don't care about wasiyah, خلاص, this died and don't care about wasiyah. But if the money is not enough, start with a dain first. However, the dain is very important to start with, as Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم once janazah came, and then he said, "Is this janazah has dayn, has debit?" And then he said, "Yes, ya Rasulullah." And then said, "I will not pray on this janazah." And then one sahabi stand, "Oh Prophet, I responsible for his dayn, but pray on him." And then he paid the dayn. So this importance also the dayn, but actually it has to be managed, depends on the dayn. I translate the second part of the hadith. لا, second part. From
you will not spend expend a thing in charity for the sake of Allah, but you will be rewarded for it, even the most of food which you
yes eat. Yes, this also showed that even the morsel of food you give it or put it in a mouth your wife, you'll be rewarded based on your attention. But be careful, the ladies will not leave any food for you. If you start with them, خلاص, you'll miss the dinner. Take at least. طيب كمل translation.
أحسن الله إليكم. It is better to leave your heirs well off than to leave them poor, begging people. You will not expend a thing in charity for the sake of Allah, but you will be rewarded for it. Even the morsel of food which you feed your wife. I said, O Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, would I survive my companions? He said, if you survive others and accomplish a thing for the sake of Allah, you would gain higher ranking and standing. You will survive them. Your survival will be beneficial to the people, the Muslim, and harmful to others, the enemies of Islam. You will survive others till the people will derive benefit from you and others would be harmed by you. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam further said, O Allah, complete for my companions their emigration and do not cause them to retract. Sa'ad bin Khaylah was unfortunate. Was unfortunate. Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lamented his death as he died in Makkah.
So after Sahabi Sa'ad ibn Khawla emigrated to Al-Madina, he returned back to Makkah again. And Prophet Muhammad sallam was sad about that because he died in Mecca and he left the Medina. And then he, because of that, he said, يعني, ولكن البائس, unfortunate Sa'ad ibn Khawla, means he died in the Medina, in Mecca. Also, this hadith showed one of the signs of that the Prophet Muhammad sallam is the Prophet from Allah Azza wa Jal. Because what happened here, he gave a glad tiding, Bushra, to Sa'ad ibn Waqas that he will be a reason for a benefit of the Muslim. And that happened. In the battle of Qadisiyah, 16 Hijra, who was the main reason after Allah Azza wa Jal to open the Iraq, Ghazwat Qadisiyah, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he asked him, I will stay alive after this death, after the sickness. And then he said, if you stay and you good righteous deed and you may be a reason for benefit for your companions, this much better for you. It happened, fa'lan, happened that Allah Azwal extended his life until he opened the Qadisiyah and spread the Islam in Ardul Iraq and the other places. ونقف عند هذا حديث number 6. Next time, inshallah, حديث number 7. طيب, any questions? طيب, يلا, take break from me tomorrow. And Saturday.